Welcome from Hollywood, California, the entertainment capital of the world. We're here on the Paramount Studios lot for CineGear Expo 2014. This is Cinema 5D on the Couch, presented by G Technology, Rode Microphones, Vitech Videocom, Post Magazine, and Owls Media. This is your host, Nino Leitner.
Welcome to another episode of Cinema 5D on the Couch, this time from CineGear 2014, from the Paramount lot. And thanks to G Technology, we are here in the Paramount studios and are able to interview Lydia and Shane Hulbert in front of an audience.
Excellent.
Hi.
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Thank you all for coming.
So before we get this started, I just want to mention, if you go to the G Technology booth after this talk, you have a chance, a very good chance, to win a G-Doc EV in a raffle. That would be at 3:30. So you're the only ones, I think, who know this. So the odds are not bad.
Gina, hit that booth.
Lydia, Shane, thanks for coming to this. It's exciting. How's the show been so far for you guys?
It's been great. I mean, I was here yesterday playing with some stuff. I love the outdoor atmosphere of this place. When it started at Universal and then eventually moved over to Paramount, it's just lower stress, and it's kind of a reconnection with just crew members and vendors and people that have really helped me along the way in my career and done favors, and it's really a great connection with all of them. And that's why I love to come. If I'm in town, I'm coming here.
So let's,
I was going to say thank you for having us.
Yes.
And this feels like old home week back at CineGear again. So.
Yeah, thank you. It's my first time here, but it already feels like family. So let's get the gear questions out of the way right in the beginning. Did you see anything exciting?
Let's see. I really loved the Movi M15. I'd done a movie in Pittsburgh that I just wrapped about a week and a half ago called Fathers and Daughters with Russell Crowe, and we were using 2 and 3 Movis the whole time on the film. And we were using the M10 with the C500 with Cook S4 glass and Gemini recorders on board. So it was kind of a heavy rig. I think it weighed out at 17 pounds. So we were taxing the M10 to the kind of its breaking point. So it was nice to have the M15 in my hand and seeing it was more stable. And I also put this wacky rig on that was able to support the thing. And I looked like Inspector Gadget. That was fun. It was really nice. Hawk Anamorphic had a vintage line of glass that looked so beautiful. It looked just like the Panavision G series, so I'm really excited to try that out. What else did we see? Zeiss had a whole new line of their wide angle zoom that I really want to test. That looks awesome. I was talking with the guys at Cineflex, because I had wanted them to do Need for Speed for all the helicopter work, because their technology is like a basketball size. And I knew that the helicopter had to get to speeds of 130, 150 miles an hour to track with these supercars. And when you have like the big space can ball, you can't go as fast. And his technology was not there yet, and now it is. So now he's flying red, dragons. He's flying Ares in this little basketball. So that was really great to see that. And then we saw the Filmotechnic guys that had done all the high-speed camera car work at A Need for Speed. And that's all I've been able to. Oh, and Zacuta had a really nice electronic viewfinder, like higher end, really great resolution, and I see that as like my eyes into now the C500. So it was really exciting to see that, and they have a EVF shootout they have their EVF, then they have a bomb EVF from the red, and then they have an Alphatron. So it's really unique to kind of see all three different versions. So that's what I've seen so far.
Cool. Yeah. So as an ASC cinematographer, you're really kind of a rare breed because you share so much information online on the whole blog and through all your education venues. How did you get started in education? Why did you decide to, basically share so much information online? Because it's not something that is not normal for, seasoned cinematographers to do that.
Yeah, well, that was my beautiful wife Lydia's idea. After we started doing Act of Valor, and I had this wacky idea that I could take a still camera and blow it up to a 60-foot screen and immerse an audience, she was like, "We got to talk about this. This is so innovative, and I think I'm going to brand you." And I was like, "What the hell are you talking about? I'm a cinematographer, not a brand." And she's like, "No, we're going to make a brand." And, it was kind of her brainchild, her vision to kind of give back and share and not keep stuff close to the chest. And, at first I was like, oh boy. I mean, I didn't embrace it at first. She had to really... convince me, and she did it so beautifully. It only took a couple weeks, maybe a month.
It was not smooth in the beginning.
Not at all, actually. I was resisting. Because I was on this trailblazing path. I wanted to. As I said yesterday in this panel discussion, I only figure the camera out once I've shot the whole film. So on, Act of Valor, I did not know the 5D. I just pushed through it using my experience and gut feeling of how to expose it and how to move with it. Only after the film was completed did I perfect that camera. So then the last 3 minutes was the next thing that we did after that. That's when I discovered the camera and knew how to use it. The same thing with the C500. The C500 was released January of 2013. We started shooting it with it January 15th of 2013 at 180 miles an hour. So that was just like drop and go. And so that kind of... learning curve is steep, and I compare myself. I'm like, there's not a road, there's not a two track. It's a forest, and I have a machete, and I'm hacking my way through this thing and trying to figure it out. And
what if the machete fails? You get the machete.
Oh, and it's trust
me, it's not good enough.
What trust me, we fail. I mean, that's part of the whole pioneering process. I mean. Mm-hmm. And that's what's so exciting and invigorating about it, and what fuels me. After Act of Valor, it just regenerated my love for just pushing the limit and just pushing boundaries and just experimenting. And it kind of got me back to my old music video days where, I'd shoot something on Super 8 film and I'd process it in my own bathtub and then drag the shit down the driveway. And you're like, I wonder what that's going to look like. And it looked unbelievable, And so that kind of, inspiration is what Lydia said. We have to bottle that. We got to create this lightning in a bottle where you can share with millions of people. Instead of touching 25, 50, 100, let's reach out.
And I think what's really exciting about it is that we get as much back from our bloggers in terms of the questions and the discussion and the things that you maybe hadn't thought of before. So it's the discussion that is exciting to me that happens on the blog.
Yeah, especially when the 5D, when we were trying to figure it out, so much was coming in that people had used it and they had this experience, and then I'd read that and then we'd bounce ideas off. It was a very open forum. Everyone was just like thirsting for knowledge and sharing. And I think it really created a wonderful revolution. And it created a revolution that we tried to be, I don't know, kind of trying to show, once I had honed in my skill with it, to try and show everyone the, be a lighthouse, be the beacon, to and continue to push knowledge and education in a way that can help them tell their stories and in better ways. And it's been so much fun. I mean, I look at it every day. I wake up, I, you know, have a laundry list that we've created of what I'm writing. We've gotten really good at projecting 3 months out now. Before it was like, okay, what do you feel like writing about? And I love that because it's much more in the moment. But now it's really, I love writing, and she's just been such a wonderful collaborator where she really is forms the direction of the Hurl blog and what we're addressing, and it's a wonderful working relationship.
And we've tried a lot over the past 5 years, and we're still constantly trying to up the bar and innovate in new ways and do what people are asking us for. So we have a lot to come, which is exciting.
Yeah.
So, but it's not only the blog. You do workshops, and you have something new coming up. You told me before. It's called Shane's Inner Circle. Can you tell us about that?
Yes. So we're creating something on the blog that will be like a Chinese takeout menu. And it's going to be education-based that is going to be for whatever you choose to be educated about. And we're going to be offering this in a kind of like Shane's store. And it's going to have a lot of different elements to it. One of the most exciting ones that Lydia and I are really, really, I didn't think it was going to be anything. And that's the best things that when that happens. I was like, she goes, all I want you to do is when you go home after you wrap, just talk about the day on the set for 5 to 10 minutes. And I was like, what? What are you talking about? She goes, no, it's gonna be awesome. I was like, all right. So I tried it, right? And then we got it transcribed. And then you all of a sudden see it all come into, because basically, and I was telling you, you know, you land in Pittsburgh and you send a tweet out. Hey, I'm in Pittsburgh shooting Fathers and Daughters. Bam, the social media hits. Hi, yeah, I'm here. Can I be a camera PA? Can I be a this? I would love to work with you. Da, 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 da. You know, can we have a drink? Can we have a coffee? You know, all that kind of stuff, which is amazing. It's so cool and I love it. But it's like I'm only one person. And how to be able to share all that knowledge, I was like, finally, Lydia, of course, came up with the solution. So I come home, I record this audio file on my day on the set. And Fathers and Daughters is 37 days. So it's day 1 through 37. And literally, it's every problem that happened on the set, my solutions to them, the workarounds, dealing with the you know, the director and camera emotion and the talent and how we would block a scene. So, you know, we were running out of light and the producer's looking at me and he's saying, you know, we got to be done in 15 minutes. And I'm thinking, oh my God, I'm looking at your shot list and there's 9 shots and you know, how can we do this? And I'm like, you know, let's just put them in the booth and let's put them side by side. And he goes, yeah, but the scene was, I go, if we put them across the table, that means over, this, you know, all around. I said, let's just put them side by side. I'll cross backlight them. And when they look at each other, they'll be perfectly lit and we'll shoot it with 2 cameras and we'll be out of here. He's like, good. You know, it's like, so that kind of activity and that blocking and all that stuff, we were in and out, gone, wrapped, 12 hours, made the day, even though there was three location moves. So it's that kind of thing. And then when you transcribe it, and now you put in all the location folders, and then you put in all the lighting schematics and the camera placements and what we used and how it was done, that becomes a very powerful tool. And it, powerful for everyone, you know, to really be the experience.
And that's something I want to address, because I think so many times, you know, this is technically more advanced knowledge, but whether you're just starting out or you've been shooting for a really long time, it's the thought process behind the innovation, and I think that that's very rare to find. Yeah. So we're trying that.
So it, I guess it's also like a self-therapy for you after the day. You know, you can, you have another chance to think about what happened.
Yeah.
No, absolutely. I mean, you kind of recall those moments, and you can kind of address and not so much second guess yourself, but kind of fine tune yourself and like saying, did I make the right decision? Yeah, I think that really was. Or, God, I shouldn't have spent this much time on this first scene. And, you know, it's a lot of that. And
it's kind of like a, because I have a forensic background, we always do a post-mortem after we do educational events or anything. What went well? What would we change for the next day or the next time? What did we love about it? Where did we struggle? It's that kind of thing.
Right. And I think it's, you kind of reflect on that, and then out of that, once I saw the audio file transcribed, it became so much more powerful, and you could really see, oh, and then, you know, I have access to the trailer and stuff, so when I'm describing light, they're actually, I'm able to do a screen grab or a little 5-second hit of exactly how I lit it, and this is what it looked like. And so it, I think it's going to be a really great, and then we're going to be enabling all the tests. So all the camera tests that I did on Need for Speed, as well as Fathers and Daughters, they'll be available to everyone in either a downloadable like 422 HQ, so you're not dealing with web compression and everything. You can really see it on a large screen and pick apart the, and it's all with commentary. So it's like a cinematographer masterclass, because I'm literally systematically going through and telling you what I'm looking at as a cinematographer, and it's not just, here's the test. And so that's a whole other thing that we're doing. And then we're gonna be doing a podcast where you're able to submit questions, as well as me kind of taking those questions and applying how I might have handled it, or so you get that practical experience, not just answering questions how to get into the business, but it's actually a practical sense of where I can use my experience and try to educate them. Mm-hmm. I got this really wonderful question asked of me, the guy who won the GoPro challenge that we had on the blog, where it was find the GoPro shot in the Super Bowl trailer for Need for Speed. And this one guy, you know, found him. And so I had an hour conversation with him. And he said, if there was one thing you could tell me, one bit of advice of becoming a cinematographer, what would it be? And I said, well, it's something that I've only learned on the 14th film, okay? So it took me 14 films to really grasp and understand this. And I said, this is my, you know, pearl that I'm giving you here. When you think about being a cinematographer, you think about what your responsibility is to deliver the director's vision. That is, that's like, and in my 14 movies, it was 100%. And that is all wrong. It's only 33%. 33% is your responsibility is delivering the director's vision. The other 33% is being a great leader and energizing your crew and igniting their passion so they will go to the end of the earth for you. And they will do everything that's necessary for you to shine. And the other 33% is you being a wonderful production-friendly director of photography that works with production in every way, shape, and form, because by doing that, you're putting it all on the screen, and that all assimilates into 100% of the director's vision.
That's 1% missing.
The 1% is my little caveat.
Your little thing.
To be able to spread here or there. But, all right, I should have said 33.3%.
There you go, 33.
That's all right. So you mentioned that you're using a lot of different tools, a lot of different cameras, you're experimenting. GoPros and major motion pictures, all kinds of cameras. You're rolling a lot of cameras at the same time sometimes. So how does your DIT or how does your camera department deal with all the media, with all this footage that comes out of that? It must be immense amount of data that you're generating there.
Oh my God. Need for Speed, we shot with 50 cameras. Okay? 50 cameras on a daily basis, and all these cameras fit into a 3-ton cube truck. Okay, on Terminator Salvation, I shot with 13 cameras, and that fit into a 10-ton as well as a 5-ton. So I'm shooting with 15 C500s, 11 1DCs, 4 Arri Alexas, and 20 GoPros. And these cameras, the idea of it is to what we called on Active Valor, blue-on-blue photography, where you just shoot yourself. Right? Everyone's just shooting everyone else. And you're able to get these amazing, unique angles that you never thought were possible because you're not worried about shooting the big ass speed rail rig that's clamped to a C500 that's 3/4 back on the Element Tech or the Lamborghini Elemento that is going to whack the P1, flip it into a roll as it, you know, the minute he taps him, the stuntman hits the plug, it launches an arm which flips him 10 feet in the air. He rolls over 20 some odd times, takes out 6 cameras, knocks him to the side, and the Elemento blows through the frame. That thing we shot with 38 cameras at once. And we destroyed 3 GoPros, 2 C500s, and a 1DC. And that was day 3. Okay.
That was like, before you started shooting.
Yeah.
I'm calling up Canon. I'm like, we're going to need a lot more cameras. And they're like, what is going on up there? You know, it was hilarious, the conversation. And all of a sudden, it was like a shining light that came down to Mendocino, because every distributor that helped Canon, they were like, we need cameras for Shane. They were coming in from everywhere. Dallas sent us 2, you know, New York sent us 2. All these places are sending us cameras. And, but yeah, it was like that kind of idea had never really been done before. And it was also taking a hybrid approach of what I did was like thinking, okay, I did this big camera test. Now, what did each camera do the best? And then I exploited that. And the GoPros were like that camera that you could not kill. We lit it on fire. We, you know, tossed it off a bridge to its death. I mean, everything possible to destroy that camera, we couldn't. The 1DC became that crash camera that, you know, the stunt guy was like, yeah, you know, we're going to kind of land over here. And, you know, foosh, you go like right over the top of like 6 of them, right? So you're like, oh. So I just started lining 10 of them up on the road. I'm like, you're going to hit one of those. So it became this very fun process to see how many cameras we could put in harm's way and how many we could just literally rip apart.
To get the footage.
To get that shot. But getting back to your story, we shot over 400 terabytes of footage on Need for Speed. And that was all managed. So imagine managing 50 cameras. and we're rolling them all the time, and we got splinter units and helicopters and all this stuff, and we had this one digital utility that we called Joe Ditt. Okay, I can't even remember what his last name was. No, it's Joe Kiakas. We called him Joe Ditka, Joe Ditt for Brains. I mean, all these kind of great terminologies we had for this guy, but he was an absolute genius. He was a coder, so he coded on his iPhone this app called Mag Tracker. And he gave it to the other digital utility because we had two digital utilities being able to manage all the cameras. And imagine the cameras were not like A, B, C, D. It was A, 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 B, A, C, A, D, A, E, A, F, A, G, A, you know, C, A, C, B, C, E. It's like, what? You know, and like the GoPros were like, you know, G, A, G, you know, B, G. It was like, how do you keep track of all this? We didn't lose 1 second of footage on this movie, and it was all because of this man's genius. And working with, we had Next Lab doing all the, from Photochem, they did all the backups on the film. So they were doing the LTOs as well as, you know, downloading them all to G Drive raids and the whole deal on that. So it was a really wonderful process to know that we would literally take the mags and we'd shoot, you know, till lunch, and then we'd hand those mags off and we'd shoot with other ones and then hand those off at wrap. And then when we showed up in the morning, everything was cleaned and erased and moving on to the next day.
Nice. I'm happy when I, you know, get 3 backups done in time after my documentary shooting day or something like that.
Yeah.
On a G Drive Pro or something like that.
But they worked around the clock. It was 24/7. They had 3 guys.
And their system was incredible. I mean, they were a well-oiled machine.
Yeah, it was very powerful programming and everything that they were. And, you know, they didn't just download the footage. They looked at it, you know, and they'd say, you know, we checked the exposure on this, or this one was out of focus. And so we would get feedback from them, you know, the next day, and we would decide, do we want to grab that again, or no, it was okay. We were never going to use that shot, or however it went. But it was great, great feedback and a really good working experience.
So with all this new gear, we all get these questions constantly from people who are starting out. I'm sure you get tons of them. You know, what camera should I buy? What lens system should I invest in? All that kind of stuff. And it gets harder and harder to recommend something because it's just so much on the market, and it really depends on the shooting needs. So would you recommend to people starting out to hire stuff? You know, would you go to a rental house instead of buying stuff?
Yes. I mean, to find your way, I think what I would say is this. Getting a 5D Mark II or getting a 5D Mark III as just a camera to be able to scout with, to be able to do video on, to get, you know, just to have that as your arsenal. And then, and you know, a couple lenses to go along with that. And then out of that, technology is changing so fast. You can't afford to keep up with this. So the rental is the only way to go about it. And back in the day when it was film, I mean, that's your only option. You couldn't afford to go out and buy a full camera package. It would cost you over $3-4 million. Yeah. Now things are becoming cheaper and cheaper and cheaper, but they're expendable. Within 6 months, it's like toss the thing in the trash because there's another thing that does 6 times what this thing did, and check it out, you know. So to navigate those waters, I think you have to just rent and try and see. I mean, like I said in this panel yesterday, they asked me about the C500 and what I thought about it, and would I use that camera to shoot the greatest game ever played, which was a period piece in the, you know, in the late 1800s, early 1900s. And I said, after Need for Speed, I would say probably not. After Fathers and Daughters, when I really figured the camera, there's nothing I don't think I can do I can do everything with this camera.
I think you're touching on something very interesting, because it used to be the case, especially, you know, for cameramen, that there was only a very limited choice of cameras that you could use, even in the 90s, early 2000s.
Oh, yeah.
So I know a lot of traditional cameramen, like TV cameramen, who were used to picking up that digibeater and, you know, just never owning one. They just get the one because it's always the same camera, basically. They know that thing. And now some of these people are struggling if they don't want to really learn. They don't want to learn, constantly keep learning new about new technology and new cameras. But I think that clients and production companies now appreciate if you're an expert in something, if you're the expert for, like you, the C500, or, you know, I know my C300 in and out, and I think that camera has got me more value than any other camera I've ever owned before. And production companies appreciate that. So it's hard to pick the right one, right?
Oh, yeah, and I think you gravitate towards it. I mean, the Canon lineup kind of grabbed my filmmaking soul, okay? And it did it in a way that I compare these digital sensors to film emulsions. And with all the testing that I've done, I feel that the C500 looks the most like Kodak film. The whole EOS line, all the way down to the 5D, the 1DC, it emulates Kodak film stock. The way it reads red and yellow, okay, that's where Kodak shined. And what do you base all your emotions on, and your vitality of your performances and your emotions on? The face, on that vitality and that emotion. And so that was something that really, you know, grabbed me. And when I was doing the color correction with the Need for Speed, I was constantly cross-cutting between Arri Alexa and C500. And you know, you just saw what the C500 would see subtle colors and energize them. It gave them energy. And I just really love that, because that's what I remembered from film. And then you find that there's other cinematographers that love Sony, and they love the feel of that, and that they love that color space. And that's an emulsion that they've understood. And there's people that love the red. And this new Dragon sensor, I mean, it's their soul. And I think that's kind of where we're going. I mean, it's the future. It's like you're going to gravitate not necessarily for the camera. You're gravitating to the sensor and what that sensor's soul delivers to you. And then you, as a storyteller, are going to choose the right piece of glass that's going to go along with your drama or your action picture. And you know, when I'm reading a script, it tells me exactly what glass I'm going to shoot. It screams off the page by reading it and how to tell the story. And then how. And it tells you what tools you're going to need, what kind of camera systems you're going to use. A Need for Speed, when you're reading it, you're reading this immersive platform that is putting you in the driver's seat at 180 miles an hour. You're not going to be doing that with a camera that's this long. You're going to be doing a camera with this size. So the script tells you exactly what's necessary, you know, and that's... It's just being open enough and understanding what it's, you know, and seeing the whole playing field and then picking that right tool.
And if I can interject, not being a cinematographer, I think it's really just choosing whatever the story dictates, but it's not always going with one thing because you're an expert in Canon, let's say, or always going with what you're comfortable with because you've shot red. And I think for Shane, you know, it's really been a lot of mixing cameras and mixing technologies because that's what the story has dictated. So I think that's the overarching, you know, it's great to be an expert in something, but then that expertise goes so far, and then it's really figuring out what is the story requiring of you as the artist.
And as an artist, I don't think you ever want to be comfortable. Anytime I found myself like settling in and going, I screw that up, right? I'm going to make that feeling go away immediately. because you have to challenge yourself. You have to kind of always push yourself and just say, how can I do this differently? How can I look at it with a different lens? Fathers and Daughters is a perfect example. I had done the C500. So where was the trailblazing there? The trailblazing came with using camera motion, taking a character and saying her camera motion is a camera that's like, feels like this, that her foundation, her soul, her character is built on sand. It's not brick and mortar. So how can I do that within a camera emotion? And the Movi came to mind, and I felt the way that camera feels, you know, let's not just use it for gimmicks and all that stuff with handoffs and ropes and this and the other. Let's use it to shoot a 6-page dialogue scene where that energy, when she moves, how the camera moves in majestic mode and how it feels, that's going to deliver the camera emotion that I think is going to help tell the story. And it's additive. It's like what's coming out of Amanda Seyfried's mouth is amazing. How can we now, you know, what the screenwriter, what he delivered, what the director's direction, that's powerful. Now, how as a cinematographer, how can I take the camera and give that some of her emotion? How can I take the lighting and give that an additive quality? And then all of that added up, you know, really, I think is the power. So the innovation on this was taking a completely untested camera system as the Movi and putting it into every cinematic drama device that we could possibly come up with. And, you know, that was a process. That was, you know, figuring stuff out, learning how to operate with this softening delay. There was a lot of things, but I think it was the right tool to tell the story, and it was very exciting for everyone involved. Like the crew just upped their ante. He goes, the operator, he had done like 70, 80 movies, and he goes, my career had been going at like this. And when you came into town, it went like that. So it's like, you know, it just re-energized his love of filmmaking because we were using a device that he'd done Steadicam for all these years. And this was a new vehicle and a new way to move the camera. And it was very exciting for everyone.
Apart from your cinematography work, you also run the company together, focusing on education and also sometimes production. And we talked about that briefly before we sat down together. Budgeting is a difficult subject for a lot of people. I mean, there is like, what do you recommend, Lydia, to people who say that, well, I have X amount of dollars, X amount of euros, X amount of whatever to do this or that? You know, it's a hard thing to allocate money to different aspects of a production.
Totally agreed. Let me first say that there's never enough money. Everybody agrees with that, I think. It's really knowing where to spend the money. And I think that that's something that is different for every project. I can speak to our experience for what we've produced. And on the ticket, locations really took a huge chunk of our budget. We felt that the locations were critically important. And then we also had actors, you know, usually a lot goes into locations and actors. And then you need to get incredibly creative with what you have left in terms of how much is going to gear and crew and, you know, all of the other pots that you need to allocate. And I think that's where the crew and the versatility of the crew and the talent of the crew really matters, because it's your crew ultimately that makes or breaks the day.
Yeah, and I mean, the ticket, for an example, Poe's vision of wanting this at the Ferris wheel at the Santa Monica Pier, that was a $57,000 night.
Oh my God.
$57,000.
For a camera test, basically. I mean, it was more than that, but it was also a camera test.
Right. So that was for that location. That wasn't the crew that day. That was just a location fee. Okay. Then we go to
West Hollywood.
West Hollywood, which is the second most expensive place to shoot in Los Angeles. And we got a little boutique shop, and that was $28,000 a day. So we had a little minuscule budget of $300,000, and the locations literally took a third of it. Now, this is not the post process, the editing process, the color correction, all that stuff on the back end that we also had to protect. But we also had to give our crew, you know, we had to feed everyone, you know. And so you got to, it's a balancing act of being able to put what is important to the director on the screen and what makes sense for Lydia as well as producing it. Like, geez, can we afford this, you know, and how do we... it's always about, like, to take an example, fathers and daughters. Richard Middleton, who is the producer, came up to me day one, and he goes, I just want you to understand that we're going to have a conversation every day. And every day, it's always about compromise and how we're going to be able to make this, because we don't have enough money for your vision. Copy. Okay, so you got to help me out. I'm like, no, you got to help me out. I need more money. No. He goes, the way you get more money is by doing it faster. And I said, okay, you got it. What does that mean? And he's like, we have to wrap at 10 hours, at 8 hours, and at 6 hours. I mean, I look back in the history of every movie I've ever made. I don't think I've ever had a 6-hour day. And we did like 3 of them.
Shane called me. It was so funny. He's like, we're done. And I looked at my watch and I'm like, you've never in the entire history of movie making ended before
in 6 hours.
12 hours, right?
12
but,
hours.
You know, 6 hours was basically an 8-hour day when they wrapped and everything. And that gained me 4 hours of money that was in the budget. So now he would take that 4 hours and now he would get me my pre-rigging crew. He would start to buy lights. He would start to get everything. And I started doing a lot of those days. And that was where I never compromised on the movie. And that is when I get to this 33.3 percentage. You know, that's really that wonderful balance that because working very closely with Richard, we were able to make this happen, and the vision and the director's vision was not sacrificed. My crew was incredibly happy. They had all the crew members that they needed. We had all our resources to light the set and to light it quickly, and it was a wonderful experience, and that is great budgeting.
Well, and if I can add, he's a brilliant producer, because what they ended up doing was this leapfrogging. So you'd have a team ahead of you, the shooting team, and then if necessary, somebody wrapping up somewhere. And it's so smart, because overtime kills any budget.
And most of the time you'll do one or maybe two company moves a day, but we were doing 3 and 4. And not like, you know, just down the street. We're talking a half hour through Pittsburgh traffic downtown at 3:30 or 4 in the afternoon, where we're moving an army. And so this leapfrog technique where we'd start to split the crew off, they would get us ready, and then they would go back and wrap the next location. And this is when it really started to, we just started to save hours, which saved money, which gave us the vision.
So I hope not too many producers see this segment. Otherwise, you know, you always have to have 6-hour days from now on.
No, I know. Trust me. It was really the director that it was all on him, because he was not somebody. Gabriel Muccino is a very talented director. He had done Pursuit of Happiness and 7 Pounds, and he knew what he needed. And he knew that when he got it, and he didn't overcover anything. And it was very refreshing.
And the actors clearly were incredible on that project and just delivered the dialogue, so it was just seamless.
Yeah. Seamless, absolutely seamless.
So before we move to audience questions to wrap this up, let's just touch one more subject. We talked about long hours, not like this shoot, but other shoots, long hours work, you know, we all have to compromise and have this, have to find this balance between work and life, which is probably, the movie industry is like the worst industry to be in to find that balance. How do you deal with this?
I'll dive into it because I love this subject. I don't believe that there is balance. I think it's, I refer to it as flow. My friend Nancy Gale and I talk about this all the time because it constantly changes. So if you're trying to achieve balance, you're always failing because you feel like you're failing the movie, you're failing your family, you're failing in all of the areas that you need to divide your time. But if you look at it as a constant flow, then certain days work has more because of whatever you have going on in work. Other days, family takes priority. And I just think that you ebb and flow. And you try not to have it be too much of a deficit in any one area.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the... And we get asked this question a lot. And I think that we made the right choice as parents to... We have two children. We have Kira is 16 and Miles is 12. And we chose to not drag them around from movie set to movie set and putting them in school systems or homeschooling them or all that stuff on location. We wanted them to have brick and mortar, a base, a grounding, a place where they could play sports and be on teams and be in drama and do dance and have friends, and those friends were friends that you know are going to be with them for life. I mean, this is how Lydia and I grew up. We grew up in a very small, I mean, we were from the same hometown. Okay, Lydia and I have known each other since we were 3 years old. Okay, that doesn't happen very often. Okay, for 3 years old, she used to come by because her dad was an Episcopal minister. And my grandmother was bedridden. And every Sunday she would come by with her dad for him to give her communion. And it was awesome. We would hang out and run around, hit on the swing, play games, whatever it was. And then we started dating in 10th grade. And we have been married for 25 years, which is a huge statement in this movie business. And we've been together for a long, long time.
But I just want to add, like, it's not simple.
No.
You know what I mean? It's not one of those things where, woohoo, you know. I am so proud of the 25 years, but it's been a lot of work.
Yes.
And I think that that's where people, you know, you have to put time and energy in just like you do to your career. And I think that it's really easy to get sidetracked and you have to make the time and you know, in this flow, make important choices. And so we wanted our kids to grow up like we did, but not everybody wants that choice. And I've got to say, being at home alone a lot is hard work. Yeah. And so it's really an individual choice for every couple and every family and every family entity.
Yeah, because I love to go off and create and be an artist and work on these movies, but at the same time, I see how much I'm missing and I don't, I mean, like Lydia and I always talk about, we got married so we could be together, not be apart. And so it's a very, yeah. I like the word flow. It's a difficult balance, a difficult flow. Oh, yes, I like that. It's a very difficult flow. But yeah, it's been, and I think that it's those small little things that you do for each other that you're constantly reconnecting on set and, you know, when you're in the trenches and you're like, God, I don't know how I can make it through this day. I can call on her and she's like, you know, just keep your head up. You know what you're doing. You know, get in there. Don't worry about it. It's, you know, it's wonderful to have such a wonderful soulmate to be able to help and drive me, because she's everything to me. And I love her.
I feel the same way. And I just want to say that communication is everything. And I think that, you know, I'm always saying this to our employees, but also obviously in a relationship and with your children, communication is everything. And as long as the communication is great, then the relationship is great. So that's a way to kind of break it down, I hope.
That's a nice way of wrapping it up, I think. But let's move on to audience questions. Are there any questions?
All right.
So going back to Need for Speed, the cameras that did get destroyed, you didn't lose data off those?
No, what was amazing was, it was funny, yesterday I was standing in the middle of New York Street and somebody came up to me and there was a Canon representative there, and he goes, "When are you guys going to put the recorder in the camera?" Okay, I'm like, you never want the recorder in the camera, right? That's the power of this platform. You can put the camera someplace in harm's way, and you have these beautiful cables coming out of it and goes to an external recorder that's powered off of a whole other deal, and you can hit that camera at 90 miles an hour, shear the Cook S4 Prime lens, send it two blocks down the road, the camera becomes circuit boards, and a homeless man comes up to you and says, "Hey, I think you lost this. This might be yours." That is the power of the platform. So, you know, it's like, you know, having a camera in or an internal recorder is not the power for me. It's being able to separate that thing and put it in a nice, cozy area so it doesn't get impacted.
So how did you do that with the one you threw off the bridge?
Well, the threw off the bridge, that was a GoPro. Right, so we put four or five off the bridge and lit them all on fire. And when they coated the camera, I'm like, "Guys, that's the camera's in there. Get that rubber cement off it." You know, I'm like, "Oh shit, that thing's burning." You know, and I'm seeing it, and you're just seeing. I'm like, "When are we gonna do this shot?" And you're just seeing the whole the housing of the GoPro just shrink wrap from the heat. It's like sitting there, just bursting into flames. And then all of a sudden, it's like, "Goosh!" They ratchet it off the bridge. Boom, right? I'm like, "Get down there and get that GoPro." And it was saved. It burned the crap out of it, melted it with an inch of its life. It cinch wrapped it to the point where we were chiseling it out of that thing. But the card was absolutely safe. It was unbelievable. So many times that way. And we would, the camera would fly apart, like blast into a million pieces, and I had a team of GoPro micro SD card finders, and they were just looking for that card. Right? I wish I had had Kira on the set. She's got cat eyes. I'm like, "All right, Kira, your job is to find the micro SD card." You know, and it was like that. It would be like, you know, like when you're trying to find a missing persons. You know, when they send out like 100 people to walk the field, that's what we did with the micro SD card. The whole camera department would just move out in this kind of lines. And they're like, "I got it. I found it." You know, and he'd pick it up and you're like, "Oh, the card." You know, he'd put it in and we'd play it. And we're like, "Oh, look at that." You know, it's like amazing.
But we're not about destroying GoPros just to destroy them.
I get it. Yeah.
How do you deal with director, like collaboration, and have you ever felt like you've kind of been turned into a camera operator? Does that make sense?
Yes. Okay, so most of the collaborations on all the films and projects that I've been on have been an amazing experience. They're selecting you, so they want to be... They're selecting you because they want to collaborate with you. So what I'm able to bring to the party, I think is gauged on how much they like my input, right? So I will read the script several times. The script will talk to me, speak to me in ways that I think this shot should be, or a crane for this thing, or dolly, or whatever it is. I will go and start to test the waters on the director and see what he's kind of gravitating towards. And if he didn't do a shot list already or storyboards of it, there's kind of no playbook. So you have to kind of test the waters to see what he responds to. And with the last experience with Gabriel Muccino, it was very weird prep for me, because I was like, I prepped for 2 weeks and then I flew to Italy and Paris and Budapest, and I was scouting a whole other movie while I was shooting this movie, while I was prepping this movie. So there was like 9 to 10 days where we were very intimate with each other for 2 weeks. And then when the movie was really getting down to selecting locations and figuring it all out, I was gone. And that was created a disconnect. So when I came back, I really had to make tons of more hours of like really trying to get in his head. And, you know, went out to dinner, hung out with him, did everything I could to really talk about the movie and really understand. I don't think there was ever a time that I've ever felt like a camera operator. There's times when they say, this is the way we're going to shoot it. And you just have to believe that. I mean, that's why they're the director. They have a vision, and sometimes you don't see it. And I've come back from that experience saying, this is never going to work. I can't believe he didn't go with my idea. And then you see it on the screen and you're like, oh shit, that was awesome. You know, it's like, so you have to trust their vision. When I was young, I would always like, yeah, but what about this? And what about that? And I would blast him with so many options that it would kind of somehow, it would even confuse them. So I've really kind of taken the path of least resistance, let's say, and throw stuff out there. And you got to understand, it's all a personality game as well, with all the different directors, and everyone on the set is a personality game. So with the with Gabriel, I wanted to just tease an idea. So when I had this idea of Amanda foundation on sand and the movie, I set that in a little email. I sent Vimeo grabs so he could look at it and just waited to see. And all of a sudden, within about 4 hours, an email came back and it said, holy, this is unbelievable. We're shooting the whole movie on this thing, right? And that was, you know, I was like, whoa, you know, and then you start to see a shot list, movie here, movie there, movie, you know. So it's really figuring the director and the personality out and coming at it in the right way to be able to help him in this process. And which, you know, that's why you're there, you know, as a cinematographer.
What were you going to say?
Or her,
yes.
No, but I think it's really the relationship that develops from what I've observed between the DP and the director is one of the most interesting relationships and communications out there, because you're so much in one another's head that, like with Gabrielli and Shane, were so close at the end of the movie that they didn't even have to speak. They were just intuiting what the other was thinking, and they would just make it happen. So it's really extraordinary to kind of watch it from meeting the person all the way until the end of the movie, and then just watching that relationship unfold, because that's what makes great art. Is when you don't have to go into so much dialogue and explanation and, oh, but I wanted this.
You know, the first week he would look at my lighting and what I was doing and everything, and he's like, you know, I was looking at it maybe a little this way, or I was looking at it a little that way, and I'd make those adjustments, and he's like, yes, yes, perfect, I love that. And then by the second week, there was nothing. We were completely in the pocket. And by week six, seven, and eight, he would literally go into the editing room, and he's like, just tell me when you're ready. And then he'd walk right to the editing room. Russell Crowe would walk right into the scene. He would tell Russell what he was doing, where he was going, and then bam, we'd be shooting. And then, okay, cut, turn around. All right, I'm back to the editing room. Foosh, you know, and then I'm back, you know, lighting the turnaround and doing all that, and then call him. And it was a wonderful experience, and one that, you know, I wanna do again.
All right. Thanks so much. We unfortunately have to wrap it up. We are already over time.
Okay.
Thanks so much for coming.
Thank you.
It was great fun.
Thank
so
you.
Much.
Awesome. Thank you for having us.
Thanks. Yeah. Thanks to our audience as well, and thanks to all our sponsors, G Technology, Vitec Videocom, Rode Microphones, Post Magazine, and Owls Media. And see you on another episode of On the Couch. Thanks.